Very good morning to all of the students. Welcome to the physics class. In this session, we will study chapter number 6 of class 11th, and the name of chapter is Newton's Law of Motion. In this chapter, we discuss the general concept of force, types of force, Newton's first law, second law, third law, moment, momentum, linear momentum, and description about the equilibrium of concurrent forces. So these are the important terms which are generally used in this chapter, and we will discuss these special topics. So start, students, and study very carefully. First of all, the concept of force. Student, as you know that, what is force? The force is an external effort in the form of push or pull, which either change the direction or tends to change the state of direction and state of rest or motion in the direction of applying force. That means with the help of a force, we can change the direction, we can change the shape and size of any object. Generally, forces are of two types: contact forces and second one is non-contact forces. So first of all, we will discuss here contact forces, the force which come into play due to a actual contact between the bodies under consideration. It means that when two bodies are actually in contact, then the force applying by any one body to on another body is called contact force. Example of contact forces are frictional forces, tensile forces, normal reaction forces, and air resistance forces. Non-contact forces, the forces which come into play without any physical contact between two bodies is called non-contact forces. That means here there is no contact between two bodies until a force is generated between these two objects. For example, electric, magnetic, and gravitational forces. Now, what is the concept of inertia? We will discuss here concept of inertia. So as you know that it is a property of a body by which any body maintain its position of rest or position of motion in any direction until any force is not applying on that object. So with the help of inertia, body generally remains its position. So it is an inherent position, inherent quality, property of any object. So examples of inertia. So as you know that there are three types of inertia: inertia of rest, inertia of motion, and inertia of direction. So some examples of inertia of rest. First one is when a bus or train suddenly starts, suddenly passenger standing inside it leans backward. So it is an example of inertia of rest, because the passenger's legs is in the straight position and bus is also in the straight position, but it suddenly moves, then the whole body remains and wants to in the rest position. That's why it leans backward direction. Second one is when a hanging carpet is beaten with a stick, dust particles are clear. So these are the examples of inertia of rest. Some also other examples: when a cart carrying a coin and placed on a bottle is flipped away quickly with a finger, the coins fall in the bottle. So it is also happens due to the inertia of rest. A bullet fired against a window glass makes a clear hole in the glass without cracking it, because the speed of the bullet is very high and it moves and strike on the glass, and the portion of a glass wants to remain in the straight position, but the bullet is the motion position. That way the whole window is remains at the straight position, and the that part where the bullet strike, it goes with the bullet. So these are the example of inertia of rest. Okay, students, now we will discuss here some example of inertia of motion. So it is the inability of a body not to change by itself its state of uniform motion along a straight line until and unless an external force is not applying on that object. So here examples are, when a moving bus or train stops suddenly, passenger standing in it leans forward. Second one is, a person getting down from a speeding bus falls in the direction of a motion of the bus. Now, an athlete runs some distance before taking a long jump. So these are the example of inertia of motion. Now we will discuss here inertia of direction. It is an inability of a body by virtue of which it tries to resist a change in its direction of motion. So the examples are mud flying tangentially to the surface of the tire of a car. When a bus suddenly turns towards right, the passenger leans towards left. So this is happened due to the inertia of direction. It tried to maintain its direction until and unless an external force is not applying. Now student, we will discuss important topic, and this is Newton's first law of motion. So what is Newton's first law of motion? So as you know that an object, it states that an object at rest tends to stay at rest, and an object in motion tends to stay in motion with the same speed in the same direction unless and until is compelled by some external force. That means if any body is moving in a straight motion, then it continue to be move, and if any body is in the state of rest position, then it try to be always in the rest position unless and until an external force is not applying on that object. Clear? So this is the Newton's first law of motion. Now student, linear momentum. So linear momentum is the product of mass of a body and the velocity. It is represented by small p, and p is equal to m into v. It is a dot product of two physical quantities, that why it is a dot product. Clear? Now Newton's second law of motion, it is also important topic. So this state that the rate of change of momentum of a body is directly proportional to the applied force, and this change take place in the direction of applied force. That means delta p upon delta, we can say that f is directly proportional to delta p upon delta t, where delta p upon delta t represent the change in momentum with respect to time. So we can write here f is equal to a singular constant m into dv upon dt. That means f is equal to k times of m into dv upon dt. This also represent the definition of force. So kf is equal to ma, where k is equal to 1. It means that we can say that Newton's second law also define a force. Now dimension of force is mLt minus 2, and the unit of force is Newton. We can also find a relation between Newton and Dyne, because Newton is the unit of force in MK system and Dyne in CG system. So there is a relation, 1 Newton is equal to 10 to power 5 Dyne, gravitational unit. 1 kg weight means kilogram weight is equal to 9.8 Newton, and 1 kg weight, or we can also say that 1 kgf is the gravitational unit of force. Now impulse of a force, when we applying a large amount of force on any object for a small time interval, then the product of force and time is called impulse. It is generally represented by capital J. So student, J is equal to F into delta T, and we know that F equals to MA, so MA into delta T. So we can write here J is equal to M into DV, and DV means change in velocity. So finally we get a relation J is equal to delta P. That means we can say that impulse is also equal to the change in linear momentum. Clear, students? Now, there are some examples of concept of impulse. First one is a cricketer moves his hand backward while catching a ball. So in order to make safe his hand, he drag his hand backward direction and catch very easily the ball. A person jumping from a height on a push-up floor receive more injury than when jumping on a push-up floor. This is also happened due to the impulse. Vehicles like cars, buses and scooters are provided with shocker. This is because when a vehicle moves in uneven road, it receives jerk from the road and shockers help to adjust the shock, and car are not damaged and can easily move on the road. Now student, we will discuss here Newton's third law of motion. This is also known as action-reaction law. So it states that every action have equal and opposite reaction. Means if we applying a force on any object, then that object also applying the same amount of force in the opposite direction. We can also write here FAB plus FBA is equal to zero. Means the total force, or you can say that the resultant of the force on the system is remains constant, is zero. Now some examples of Newton's third law of motion. Walking on a ground, walking on stand or ice, pulling a cart by horse. These are the examples of Newton's third law of motion. Swimming, flight or jet plants, planes and rockets. So these are the examples of Newton's third law of motion. Now students, we will discuss a most important topic here, law of conservation of momentum. Law of conservation of momentum states that if we consider a system and this system is made by number of particles and every particle have a momentum p1, p2, p3 and so on, then the total momentum or the total change in the momentum of a system remains constant. That means remains, there is no change in the total momentum of a system if there is no external forces applying on that system. That is delta P upon delta T is equal to zero when there is no external forces working. So this derivation can be easily drawn because we know that P is equal to P1 plus P2, and now delta P is equal to delta P1 plus delta P2. Dividing by delta T, we get delta P1 upon delta T is equal to delta P1 upon delta T plus delta P2 upon delta T. We know that delta P1 upon delta T is equal to F1. The same way delta P2 upon delta T is equal to F2. So total force F is equal to F1 plus F2 plus F3 and so on. And if there is no external force, that means capital F equals to zero. So the sum of all the forces working on the system is also remains constant. This is the law of conservation of momentum. The example of law of conservation of momentum is recoil of a gun, earth and ball jumping from the boat to the shore. Clear? Flight of a rocket, explosion of a bomb. So these are the example of Newton's third law of motions and law of conservation of momentum. Now student, Newton's second law is the real law of motion. So as in the starting of the lecture I told you, Newton's second law defines the definition of force. So we can say that Newton's second law is the real law of force because it defines accurately the motion and the force working on that object. Clear? So with the help of Newton's second law, we also define the definition of force. Now there is a question, Newton's third law can drive with the help of second law. So we can also drive Newton's third law, means action-reaction law, with the help of Newton's second law. So from impulse. We know that impulse equals to change in momentum, that means F into AB into delta T is equal to delta P1. In the same way, delta P2 is equal to F AB into delta T. From law of conservation of momentum, total momentum remains constant on a system. So delta P1 plus delta P2 is equal to 0. On putting the value, finally we get F AB is equal to minus times of F BA. So it represents Newton's third law of motion. Free body diagram. If any object move freely from any pulley system or any system by which its direction it remains changes, so this diagram are generally known as free body diagram. Examples: motion of a connected bodies. Two bodies connected by a string passing over a smooth pulley. This is the diagram, and in this diagram the motion of both two objects are considered as a free body diagram. If their masses are m1 and m2 and their accelerations are a, which are working from the pulley system, and t is the tension which is working in the rope, then there are two formulas are consider here. First, a, where a is the acceleration produced in the pulley system and in the whole body system. So it will be a is equal to m1 minus m2 upon m1 plus m2, where m1 and m2 are the masses of both two objects, and capital G is the acceleration due to gravity. We can also calculate tension produced in the rope system, and it will be capital T is equal to 2 times of m1 m2 upon m1 plus m2 into G. So with the help of these two formula, we can easily calculate the tension and the acceleration. With the help of acceleration, you can also calculate the force working on each two objects. Okay, students. We can also calculate acceleration and tension by another object which is placed on a table, and one object is hanging from the pulley system in downward direction and the second object is placed on a table smoothly. In this case, the acceleration becomes A is equal to m1 upon m1 plus m2 into g, and T is equal to m1 m2 upon m1 plus m2 into g. Okay, students, now this topic is out of course because it is optional and it is not used in the 11th class. But sometimes in the competitive exam, this can be happen. So we will study this topic after some time. So the next topic is concurrent forces. So what is concurrent forces? Now, see students, if the forces applied to a body are such that their lines of action meet at a single point are called concurrent forces. So you can see in the diagram there are three forces, F1, F2 and F3, which are working on a system and at the same point O. Their directions are different, so their angle made by the horizontal axis, that is x-axis, is alpha 1, alpha 2 and alpha 3. So capital R is the resultant of all the forces F1 plus F2 plus F3, and we will resolve two components of the resulting force capital R along x-axis and y-axis. So Rx is the component of R along x-axis, and it will be F1 cos alpha 1, F2 cos alpha 2 plus F3 cos alpha 3. In the same way, Ry is equal to F1 sin alpha 1 plus F2 sin alpha 2 plus F3 sin alpha 3. Now the magnitude of the resultant will be capital R is equal to under root Rx square plus Ry square, and tan alpha is equal to Ry upon Rx. So we can calculate that angle and the resultant of all the forces which are working on a single point, that means they are concurrent. So student, in this lecture we discuss some important topics, and You have to study this chapter very well because this is an important chapter, and in competitive exams some points and some definitions and some important terms are generally asked. So this is important chapter according to your syllabus as well as competitive exam. So read and learn this chapter very well. Okay, thank you very much.